It's Auntie Caroline. Remember her? What was I
thinking? No. No, nor do we. But back in 1997, the nation was blown away by an impromptu performance from her niece.
Charlotte's got a fascinating story because she was discovered on a talent show called The Big, Big Talent Show with Jonathan Ross to introduce her auntie on the show. So it was her auntie that was actually performing, her Auntie Caroline.
This was the debut performance of the Welsh wild child, Charlotte Church. Wasn't she sweet back then?
So Caroline's your auntie. Yeah. She sings, I know, beautifully. I know you have a great voice as well. It's a different sort of style to your aunt, is that right?
Very different. I'm a soprano. I'm into opera.
I think the real shocking thing about when we saw Charlotte Church with Jonathan Ross on that show was 11 years old, more confident than Jonathan Ross, chillingly precocious.
Will you give us a little burst?
Of course. Please, can I get a C off the orchestra?
C off the orchestra? Well, you can try. They haven't been hitting them this evening.
Come on, orchestra. Where's me C?
No, she was 11 years of age, but had the most amazing vocal ability.
None of us were expecting that sort of a voice out of a child. You can tell this girl's going to go far.
Wow, what about that?
She was an average 11-year-old, but could sing like an angel.
We've all gone tingly, haven't we? Fantastic.
And with that, a star was born.
And I went down to Cardiff and auditioned Charlotte in her singing teacher's front room, and Charlotte completely blew me away in a manner that no other artist had ever done up to that point. I actually could envision Charlotte Church at the Hollywood Bowl and places like that. And indeed, 2 years later, Charlotte Church was at the Hollywood Bowl in Hollywood.
Little Charlotte went on to sell over 10 million records worldwide.
She sang for Bill Clinton and the Pope and Rupert Murdoch. She has had the most amazing career, and I'm sure we haven't seen the last of her.
Tara Palmer-Tompkinson, I'm crazy as a box of frogs, Mayhem Academy, you have been warned.
When naughty but nice it girl Tara Palmer-Tompkinson, TPT for short, turned up on Comic Relief Does Fame Academy, no one knew quite what to expect.
She was a nervous wreck backstage, absolutely, you know, petrified about going on.
My rehearsal was awful, my dress fell off.
Well, we all thought that, she was a bit, you know, not quite right.
Oh, my gosh, it was dreadful.
She so couldn't sing. She knew she couldn't sing.
So she went in probably feeling, you know, I'm going to be in here for one night anyway because people hate me.
You're magnificent.
I'm the one going.
No,
I am.
Tara was Fame Academy's underdog, albeit a pedigree one, and we all know how much viewers love one of those. They kept voting her through.
As the week went on, she just transformed and began to understand what it was about. If you have a
minute, why don't we... And she got really good at singing. Talk about it somewhere only we know. Oh, who are we kidding? This
could be the... Didn't have a great voice, but she had a great sell.
I think Tara had probably about 20 moments in Fame Academy where she was about to walk, but every time she overcame.
She did. In fact, she overcame the fact that she couldn't sing all the way to the grand final.
She threw herself around that stage and was growling and having a wave of a time and actually deserved praise for that. Because it wasn't... She didn't care if she was hitting the notes.
I loved that about her, that she was fearless.
And then something really shocking happened.
The winner is...
Tara!
real surprise was that she went and won it, which underdogs normally get to maybe fourth or third or something like that, and then they go, OK, well, you know, you've had your day, you've done very well, but let's have the real talent win. But Tara went ahead and won it, even though she couldn't really sing.
It was a moment, and it still makes me emotional talking about her now.
The audience and the public just said, we care more about personality than we do about talent.
The Apprentice, the show where contestants are eager to demonstrate to Lord Sugar their business talents.
Kate, you'll be pleased to hear that your advertising campaign will seem to be the best one.
But the wannabe entrepreneurs we remember most are those who shocked us not with their talent for business.
Oh, that's perfect.
I think it's like a nappy.
But their lack of it.
I've had an honorary scholarship to Sandhurst, and that shows.
We start with Ben, one of Sir Alan's more notorious candidates for cannon fodder, and who we remember for one reason only.
OK, so you're going to want to talk about this scholarship to Sandhurst thing, and I understand, but I wasn't talking about going to Sandhurst all the time.
No, Ben, not all the time.
The reason that you shouldn't fire me, Sir Alan, is because I've shown you that I've got raw business talent. I've shown you that I've got raw acumen.
Well, let's stop there.
Wait for it.
I've had an honorary scholarship to Sandhurst, and that shows that I have leadership potential.
I'm banging on about bloody Sandhurst again.
But it shows,
you know,
I've got potential.
I was in the Jewish Lads Brigade, Stanford Hill Division.
It was all about a ticket to the big boys' club, wasn't it? Look, I wear boxers, I shave, I had a scholarship to Sandhurst. It was that. He wanted to be a man.
So, yeah, it was one of those things he's very, very proud of. Rightly so. Did he go?
I haven't gone to Sandhurst yet. I've still got the option to.
Well, it's always good to keep your options open. Our next apprentice shocker comes courtesy of a now legendary breakfast cereal commercial featuring underwear worn as outerwear.
I think essentially you get one opportunity to you know, to go through this process and be on television and showcase yourself. Whether it be a good thing or a bad thing, I had Pantsman that people remember me for.
Oh, Phil Pantsman.
It's so natural you feel naked but with pants.
I think the whole idea of the pants thing just might sway the mother away.
Creatively, I think Pantsman was my greatest moment. And, you know, especially singing the jingle as well. I've got a cracking voice.
When you wake up and your belly's rumbling, you gotta dance in your pants till you get your belly filled. If you are after work or if you are after school, you gotta dance
we
in your pants.
We think their reactions speak for themselves.
Dance in your pants. Dance in your pants, dance in your pants, dance in your pants.
In terms of marketing, in terms of business, and in terms of just common sense, the world's biggest disaster.
Pants of the future.
I think that's verging on being silly now.
Anyone that comes up with the idea of making a breakfast cereal with a man with a pair of pants over his trousers is frankly a genius in my books, because it's never going to win and it's a guaranteed ticket to the boardroom.
Wake up call, put your pants on the right way.
This is absolute garbage.
2 years down the line, people are still talking about Pantsman. So as it goes, as an advertising exercise, people remember it.
And frankly, for that, he wins my prize of Man of the Year.
Next, a shocking and ever so tearful moment from pop stars The Rivals.
We'd been told that night that two people were getting eliminated. So the emotions in the room, the energy in the room was just absolutely... It was quite scary, really.
And as the contestants sang on the live show for their place in boy band One True Voice, little did they or we know what was to come.
It was my second week. I went and sang a song, it was Stevie Wonder number. I went backstage, getting ready, as you did, to go back out to... for the judgment. I was confident, I was feeling good.
But confidence and a general sense of well-being count for nothing if you've been lying about your real age.
We had got a call in the gallery during the live show to say we think he's overage.
They had sent a detective to Dublin to do a birth cert search, and it was confirmed that I was a couple of months too old.
Pete had actually submitted his fake student card. We called him into a room. And we said, this has come up, is it true? Because if it is true, it makes you ineligible. And if you're already here, you've taken someone else's place. I think he fessed up pretty quickly.
The results are in.
And we said, well, then you're going to have to resign. And we think you owe it to the viewers to do it live.
OK, you guys shuffle up a bit.
I did whisper to the director that something might happen that's not planned for. and that we just need to go with it.
That one of you from each group is going to be going.
I need to talk. There's something I need to tell you. Something I need to talk to you about.
And then he announced it.
Sorry for interrupting. I'm two months too old to be in this band. Yeah.
You could hear everybody in the audience gasp. I'll never forget that.
It was a shock. It was a shock.
So I went to Pete earlier. I said, look, Pete, I can't do this. I just can't do it anymore. I'm sorry, Lou, but I can't watch the boys anymore.
It's a real pleasure to have with us. And not only just has he been inspirational, but he's been one of the most charming people to work with, hasn't he?
As the show drew to a close, the boys were crying, the judges were crying, and the rival girl band were crying. Whatever happened to them?
What on earth are these people sobbing about? Pull yourselves together. They all broke down. Peter had actually visited Mystic Meg and realised that band was about to become one true voice who would have one sort of dire second-rate hit and then disappear forever, and got out quick.
And I didn't kill anyone. I just wanted to bloody well sing.
Former England goalkeeper David Seaman, two-inch steel blades and slippery rock-hard ice. No danger there, surely.
Pam O'Connor clearly didn't understand that as a goalkeeper, David Seaman, safe hands, ironically, as he was known, did have the occasional lapse.
But in series one of Dancing on Ice, Safe Hands and Pam were doing quite well. So well, in fact, that in the quarterfinals, they decided to try a particularly tricky manoeuvre.
It's been hugely built up in the press that David Seaman's going to do the headbanger.
But as the celebs skated out of the tunnel at the start of the live show, someone was missing.
You may have noticed that David and Pam did not skate on with all of our other stars. That's because earlier today, during rehearsals, something happened which means that for this week only, David will not be skating.
And, of course, we had the big drama, not knowing where Pam was, what had happened to her.
And you think, oh, my God, what's happened? Is she died or something?
And we'll be finding out why and chatting with David a little later.
Philip Schofield, never one to milk the drama for maximum impact on Dancing on Ice, he then talked us through gradually the circumstances behind her absence.
Now, it all looked good for tonight's performance until an hour ago in rehearsal when this happened.
And you instantly know something awful's gonna happen. And you're watching it through fingers like this. Me and my husband were watching it and we just both went, ay. And I still can't watch that on YouTube or anything. Hate the moment. It was just horrendous.
The reaction from everybody around in the arena was one initially of sort of stunned silence, followed immediately by people dashing across.
David Seaman's injuring of his partner, Pam O'Connor, was one of the rare times where the injury has been palpably serious.
Happily, despite all the studio drama, Pam's injury wasn't as serious as first feared, and the show could go on.
The word from the hospital is that Pam's had a few stitches under her chin, but she's also banged her other shoulder as well, and that she's having it x-rayed right at this moment now.
She had a few stitches, so she's okay. It's all right. Next week, they'll be back.
Still to come, a very surprising contestant pops up on Stars in Their Eyes.
A musician with everything to lose.
Girls Aloud singer gets caught telling porkies.
There's nothing that girl will not do to get in the band.
And a unique rendition of a Britney classic.
What are you doing?
You're watching the 50 most shocking talent show moments. Here's one that may make you want to rip your own ears off. Christmas 2009.